the truth about the Lakers' dominance, with a 12-2 record on the road, despite getting in altercations with fans in both Cleveland and most infamously Atlanta with courtside Karen, LeBron's still been the clear MVP frontrunner. And while the Brow AD struggled with his jump shot, he still had at least 3 blocks in 9 games already. In this video, you'll find out the secret to LA's ability to embarrass teams away from Staples, and stay tuned to see how their offseason additions around their all-time great duo stack up against the top championship contenders. If you're already subscribed, welcome back to D-Flow Hoops. If you're new here and a basketball fan interested in NBA rankings, predictions, and stories, welcome aboard. You came to the right place. Please subscribe and hit notifications so you're updated every time I post content. Now let's get into this. For the rest of the NBA, the scariest part about the Lakers, who were the first team to reach double-figure wins and are half a game back of Utah for the league's best record, is that they have plenty of room to grow on both ends of the floor. While they've been number one in defensive efficiency this year, last year, LA was a league fifth best in steals per game. This season, they're down at number 21 in that area. Expect that mark to improve. More on the defense coming up later on, but offensively, what you can't forget is that Schroeder, Harrell, and Gasol have only played 23 games in Laker uniforms, and they're still adjusting to the flow of LA's championship-winning system. So it's not surprising that LA is turning the ball over at the 19th worst rate in the league and averaging nearly 15 turnovers per game this season. There's a lot of pressure that comes along with defending a title, and the Lakers seem to feel that on January 18th in a home game against the Golden State Warriors. That night marked the first time in 294 career regular season games across his 18-year career that LeBron's team has coughed up a double-digit lead going into the fourth quarter. The Lakers just dominated the second half against the Nuggets to improve their record at Staples to 5-4, but that's still a bad record for a top contender. However, when LA takes the show on the road, their problems seemingly vanish, while no fans, or in some cases less fans, somewhat evens the playing field. The Lakers' success on the road is still surprising, because with the NBA's strict protocols for COVID-19, road trips, which used to be fun bonding moments for teams to develop chemistry, are now isolated adventures. Players stay in their hotel rooms and only interact with one another in team meetings or at the arena when they're playing. But the leadership of Coach Frank Vogel, AD, and of course LBJ aren't allowing the Lakers to get down on themselves, and the team is instead using the protocols as a way to completely lock in. The Kings said after the Lakers finished a road trip 3-0 last month, quote, "We just have a bunker mentality. When we go on the road, it's just us. And obviously, it's even more than just us because of the restrictions and the COVID and everything that's going on. So we come together even closer. So we go on the road, we understand it's going to be challenging and different because we're not at home, we're staying at a hotel and things of that nature, which allows us to zero in." And as you saw when LA visited ATL on February 1st, on the rare occasion rowdy fans are in attendance, which they are in 10 out of 30 NBA arenas right now, the focus of the Lakers, specifically LeBron James, is augmented. Even though LeBron and courtside Karen got into it in a moment that broke the internet, James revealed after the game the argument was between him and the woman's husband, and he didn't think they should have been ejected from the game. With fans in attendance, LeBron's embracing the atmosphere twice as much than he usually does. As he said after the game, "At the end of the day, I'm happy fans are back in the building. I miss that interaction. I need that interaction. We as players need that interaction. I don't feel like it was warranted for them to be kicked out. That was a back and forth between two grown men. We said our piece, he said his piece, I said my piece, and then someone else jumped into it and said their piece. I didn't think they should have been kicked out, but they might have had a couple drinks, and they could have probably kept it going, and the game wouldn't have been about the game anymore, so the referees did what they had to do." And this isn't the first incident LeBron's had with spectators during this road trip. In Cleveland last week, James missed a shot at the end of the third and was visibly aggrieved with how a Cleveland executive reacted. Also, there was a fan courtside in Cleveland who held up several t-shirts which were completely offensive. I'm not going to give them the light of day by saying them. Pause to read them if you're interested, though. Point is, the King responded to those Cleveland fans by putting up 21 points in the fourth quarter, 46 points in the game total on 19 of 26 shooting, and a stellar 7 for 11 from deep range. But what's most staggering about LeBron James, and something we should all pay respect to, is the fact that he went to 8 straight finals last decade. The man's in his 18th career year, yet the mileage hasn't caught up to him whatsoever. He's leading Joel Embiid, Nikola Jokic, and Kevin Durant, and is the top candidate for the 2021 MVP, putting up 25 points, 7.8 boards, 7.7 dimes per game on very efficient shooting splits. Not to mention he's missed 0 games for the second seed in the West. I made a separate video on how his jumpers adapted to the modern NBA. Go watch that right after this by clicking the link in the top right. He's shooting a career high 40.9% from 3-point range. But a stat that also signifies LeBron's value is that the Lakers have a net rating of plus 11.3 when he's on the floor and minus 1.4 when he goes to the bench. Coming up, you'll hear about every player around LeBron and the new additions of Schroeder, Gasol, and Harrell. Before that, I have to talk about the second option, Anthony Davis, who's about to be featured in his first Super Bowl commercial this Sunday, signifying how marketable of a player he's become, both on and off of the court. Davis averaged 27-10 to go along with 1.4 blocks during the Lakers' title run. He made the biggest shot of the playoffs and led the postseason in plus-minus. But Davis struggled with his shot to begin this season, and he's shooting a career-low 70% from the free-throw line, while he is shooting just 16.7% from three-point range in his last 10 games. Anthony's had some great performances lately, including a 37-point game in his hometown of Chicago, and against courtside Karen and the Hawks, he shot 10 of 14 from the field. At AD's best, the floor spacing and explosiveness he provides, plus the way in which he transitions to the position on the floor he wants to attack after setting a screen, that all make him the ideal pick and roll outlet for any ball handler. Also, Davis is so good at using all the attention he gets from defenses and translating that into easy buckets for his teammates. Now on to the role players, starting with the new additions. Dennis Schroeder, who was runner-up for Sixth Man of the Year award in 2020, in the rematch of the Western Conference Finals, dove on the floor twice on one possession. Here's what Vogel had to say about that after the game. Anytime a player dives on the floor for a loose ball in front of his coach, that's going to excite the coach, so we definitely look for that kind of hustle. Dennis fits into our identity of being a really hard-playing dude, and when we have that kind of speed and intensity on the perimeter with guys like AD and Bron, we're going to be a tough team to beat. Not only does Schroeder take the pressure off James with his ability to manufacture shots off the bounce, but as Coach Frank alluded to, Dennis is an elite hustle player, and that's a requirement at the historically great point guard position he plays at. The German's numbers this month, albeit just 2 games thus far, are starting to resemble what he did in OKC last year, and it's starting to become clear that this man was the point guard LA was looking for the entirety of last decade. In the 2010s, Kobe could have certainly used a tough point guard next to him like Dennis Schroeder. He's starting to get more comfortable in the championship system, and as the year progresses, the thought of him becoming even better next to the two LA superstars is scary for the rest of the league. Then there's the 2026 Man of the Year, Montrezl Harrell. Combine his 6'8", 240-pound frame with his athleticism, and you've got one of the most efficient players in the league. Currently ranked 4th in league-wide field goal efficiency, Harrell can both attack the rim with reckless abandon and quickly leak out in traffic. Those two qualities have made Trez the perfect big man for LeBron to connect with. Marc Gasol's shooting struggles from last playoffs with the Raptors have continued, but he significantly helped the flow of the Laker offense. The ball moves seamlessly and swiftly, with Big Spain dishing out dimes at the center spot, and having a Gasol in town worked out the first time around for LA. Mark's great for a team's chemistry, he can hit the occasional three, and can lock down elite opposing centers, specifically Joel Embiid. But you can't forget about the G League call-up Talen Horton-Tucker, who's making a name for himself in the pros this year. Tucker just dropped a crucial 17 points in the win against the Nuggets. The man has great size for a shooting guard at 6'4 and a bulky 234 pounds. Expect him to play a fairly big role off the Laker bench. However, the roster continuity is the true backbone to LA's success. In year 2, the chemistry of the 1-2 punch is only getting stronger, And whether it's Kyle Kuzma taking a charge, then hitting a three, the bald-headed Mamba Alex Caruso getting a steal and then throwing it down, the Lakers' depth is an underrated factor to their success. Speaking of underrated, a valuable, sparingly mentioned floor spacer around the King and the Brow is Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. He's 8th in the NBA in three-point percentage, shooting a blistering 47.4% from distance while taking 4 threes per game. With all of this firepower, the Lakers can shut teams down for long stretches and win the game in that time span. For example, the Lakers were trailing against the Nuggets all game, but dug in deep to go on a 15-0 run at the end of the third quarter against the Nuggets. They also went on a 13-0 run to miraculously take the lead against the Sixers in the dying seconds, but Tobias Harris broke their hearts. That win would have improved the Lakers' record on the road to 11-0, but 12-2 is still pretty damn good, and this proves they can take the Lake Show on the road and dominate in any building they play in. Let me know your favorite part about the Lakers so far and I'll respond to your comment. Follow me on Instagram and Twitter at DFlowHoops. Leave a like to help this video spread to more people. You're the best for sticking around. This was DFlow, and I'll see you next video.